that's when customers ask that, it's not a straightforward answer, unfortunately, but because it all depends on how much solar you have and how much you're offsetting the usage during the day. But on average, whether it's a motorhome or a fifth wheel, they're the most common with the residential fridge. Those customers, if they want the ability to use the air conditioner at will, meaning maybe they want to use it in a, when they stop at a rest area, when they stop to get gas, to have lunch, when they want to cool the coach down before the sun goes down. And then once the sun goes down, they open the windows. But residential refrigerators, on average, over our experience, it's very common for them to use about 150 amp hours a day. It's very common for the average customer with just normal life, watching TV, charging your phones, etc., to use about 150 amp hours a day. Now you're at 300 amp hours for the fridge and your life. If you throw the air conditioner on top of that, well, then obviously you're going to be consuming more. So the most common system for residential fridge customers, to get back to the original question, is about 800 amp hours is a good starting point. 800 amp hours and 1,000 watts of solar and a hybrid inverter is very common. If a customer's going to be really relying on the air conditioner quite a bit and they don't want to supplement it with a small generator and hybriding, then you're going to go 1,000, or some customers have gone up to 1,200. We get that question quite a bit, and I think there's some confusion about that, and that's when I start clarifying things with the customers. So the solar panels do not run anything that's AC current, alternating current. Solar system is a battery charger. So you need the solar system, you need the battery system, and you need an inverter system to convert the DC power into AC power. And then obviously the monitoring. So there's three parts that you have to have. And if you're going to be using your RV and you're not plugged in, you have to know what's going on with the batteries and the solar. So you have a management system, a battery monitor. I break things down into high draw short term and high draw long term to try and simplify it when we're talking with the customer. The everyday life of running lights, running the TV, charging your phones and your iPad and your computer and running the furnace, etc. Those are all just everyday items. There's a natural parasitic draw that all RVs have. We can talk about that real quick. And that's basically when your coach is shut off, like you're either going to bed or you're putting it into storage, but you're not physically disconnecting the batteries. Every RV, Class A, fifth wheel, towable, have a parasitic draw or a base load. On a typical Airstream, for example, that base load is typically 1.3 to 1.5 amps. 24 hours a day, you can't get rid of it. Why? There's a few electronics in the RV, but the LP detector is usually always powered in an RV. And if you're using your RV, then all the circuit boards, the furnace, the water heater, and the refrigerator that runs on LP, they all take DC power to control them, even if they use LP, for example, like the fridge, to cool. So that base load needs to be accounted for in your solar system. The lower draw items, such as the towables, 1.3, some of them are 2.5 times 24 hours a day, you can be consuming at least 50 amp hours, 30 to 50 amp hours a day with doing nothing in your RV. And then on the other extreme, are some of the newer motorhomes and fifth wheels. They have digital touchpads for the lights, the furnace, the fantastic fan. They have dimmers. All of those items are being run by a DC computer somewhere in the RV. And the highest draw I saw was on a country coach. And when everything was turned off, when they were going to bed, it was dark in their RV. That RV consumed 15 amps 24 hours a day before they did one thing in the RV. That customer needs a lot more batteries and solar than somebody who has a smaller draw. So that's just one example of the starting of building a solar system. What does that equate to? On average, every 100 watts of solar in June 21st, summer solstice, the highest, sunniest, longest day there is, you will typically make 25 to 30 amp hours a day per 100 watts of solar. Then you get into where we're heading now into winter solstice. So in another 5 weeks or so, December 21st, the shortest day of the year, the sun's at the greatest angle. That's going to be your worst solar day. And you can lose 30 to 40% of your solar output just because of the shortness of the day and the angle of the sun. So you need technically more solar in the winter. There's a few customers out there that do the tilting of the panels and everything. But to be honest, people read about that, they talk about it, it sounds cool, but in my experience, it's like done once or twice, and then it's typically not done again. There's a few diehards that will go camp out in the desert, and they can align themselves just properly to the south, and they've got all their panels lined up so they don't have shadows or anything. Sure, you can tilt your panels up, and you can replicate June, but that's not common. That's the hardcore customers.